So, dear friends, we are almost in the middle of August, and there are so many things that are happening. Perhaps something's good, something not so good, but our faith and trust in the Lord takes us every day to the second level, to a higher level. Let me begin with the message of this weekend. Basically, I would say it's a two-pronged message. Firstly, I would say it's a message to welcome the others, especially the foreigners amongst us, that God loves the others. We know what we are. And most of the time, perhaps we are circulating ourselves into our own circle. But today God opens up this circle and welcomes everyone in His kingdom. Secondly, the aspect of faith. I shall explain. First of all, as I said, can we call it a foreigner's Sunday today? Because all the three readings speak about foreigners or the outsiders. Outsiders. You know what's a family? It's perhaps a closed circle of people related to each other. We know what's a community, the people who are with us, or people who are around us, people whom we are known. Perhaps we even know what is a diocese, or perhaps before that, what's a parish. We know that. And in this understanding, many a time it happens that we are a closed circle. We don't want to welcome others. We are very suspicious of outsiders. We are critical of those that are not of our own language, of our own culture. They are foreigners, we say. And this world, this church, this society, this benefit is for us. Perhaps Jesus breaks this circle today. You know, as I said, all the three readings speak of foreigners. The first reading from the book of Isaiah starts with a sentence. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to Him, to love the name of the Lord. And there I will bring them to the holy mountain. God wants to bring the foreigners to the holy mountain. As if they belong to us, they should belong to us. And in the second reading, St. Paul's once again says, brothers, now I'm speaking to you Gentiles. He's speaking to the Gentiles. You know, among the Jews, the Gentiles were not only the foreigners, but the ones who were despised. They were of a different faith. And the Jews were not supposed to mix with the Gentiles. They always considered them as outsiders, as foreigners, as enemies. That much was sort of their emotion towards the others. And so St. Paul says, lovingly to the Gentiles, to the foreigners, brothers, now I am speaking to you Gentiles, that in as much I am also an apostle to the Gentiles. He seems to say that I am taking up for you. I am not taking up for my own people, I am taking up for you. And almost tongue in cheek, he tells the Jews, I magnify my ministry in order to make my fellow Jews jealous. You know, St. Paul had a strategy. When the Jews refused to hear the message, the good news, he said, perhaps I will go to the Gentiles. So the Gentiles are welcome. And in the Gospel, we have a pointed example of what means a Gentile. And there's this Canaanite woman in Matthew chapter 15, verse 21 to 28. A Canaanite woman. The Canaanite is one who is on the Syrophoenician side, a Samaritan woman who doesn't belong to the caste or perhaps to the group of the Jews. And therefore, she is an outsider. And she comes to ask favor to Jesus. And Jesus also, perhaps in that tradition of the what we call the Jews and Gentiles, at first, he seems to not to notice her or perhaps listen to her prayer. It's not right to take the children's bread and give it to the dogs, says Jesus to her. And she gives back to Jesus and says, perhaps very humbly, that even the dogs have a right to the crumbs that fall from the table. I shall come to their aspect of faith a second, a little while later. But before that, Jesus also receives this Canaanite woman. So therefore, I say that, first of all, let us reflect a little. How much are we to reception of the foreigners, the outsiders among us? You know, there are so many instances where we show the people that you don't belong here. You are not of my stock. You are not of this, perhaps, group. Many a time, because of our differences of caste, creed, language, race, there are so many problems. We reject some people. But today, perhaps we can say, it's a loving day to receive the foreigners, the outsiders among us. You know, Jean-Paul Sartre, a philosopher, you know, he was a very critical and negative type of philosopher. For him, you know, he had that attitude to say, it's the other is hell. The other is hell, meaning to say that the other person, we should not entertain him. Perhaps not so strongly, but sometimes even lightly or surface, we also have this tendency among us to reject the others. We can imagine, we can reflect also, whom am I rejecting? Am I opening myself to everybody? You know, I say this in the context of our own archdiocese. There are so many, it's a cosmopolitan city. People have come from so many places. And nowadays, even the migrants are coming in. And we cannot say that they are outsiders, that they don't deserve our pity, our sympathy. You know, we have received the Manipuris in our archdiocese. There are almost 700, 800 of them who have given me not only welcome, but a reception. They have given a place to stay. They have been given a place to be educated. And that's how we have looked after them. Thanks be to God, our priests and religious, especially the CRI, and also many families, many donors, many benefactors have reached out to us, you know, to help them. I think this is our small way of saying that the foreigners or the outsiders are welcome into our church, into our society. The second aspect of the gospel, as I said, is the faith. Jesus tests the faith before he can grant anything. You know, sometimes when we get certain things very freely, there's no value. But when you climb and you struggle for it, I was just seeing a clip on the, what we call the rock climbing, you know, how difficult it is, how dangerous it is. You miss one step, you come down 100 feet, perhaps you can even die, crash and die. But then after you have climbed it, what joy, what joy. So also perhaps Jesus wants to test our faith before he can present us with something that we are asking for. Are we really serious? Or is it just sort of a babbling that I ask this, I ask that, I ask to change another one, I keep on changing, I don't remember what I prayed yesterday. It's not that. Jesus wants to test the faith. And therefore, this woman is tested in our faith when Jesus tells her, the word says, it's not right to take away the children's bread and give it to the dogs. But this woman who wants from her heart, she's hungering for this gift, that namely that her child, her girl be cured, that be delivered from the powers of the Satan, because she's suffering a lot. And therefore, she is possessed by the demon and she wants to be released. And that's why she tells Jesus that even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the table. And Jesus' answer to her is, your faith is great. And therefore, may it be done to you what you desire. So therefore, perhaps God is also testing our faith. I know the people who are praying seriously. Sometimes when you go to the pilgrim places, you can make out from their faces, from their sort of conditions, that they are desperate. And many a time they pray with faith, and so God will not disappoint. Sometimes perhaps God may not give the things that we want, but he will surely bless them because of their faith. So my dear friends, I leave it at this. As I said, two little things to remember. first of all, to welcome the foreigners amongst us, the foreigners, the outsiders, the Gentiles, the leftovers, the marginalized, the poor, always to welcome them. And secondly, to strengthen our faith. I now take you to the second point that I've written here, namely, 27th of this month, that means the next Sunday, we celebrate what's called the Social Justice Sunday. Perhaps someone can ask, what's the meaning of this Social Justice Sunday? We know what is social, something that pertains to everybody. What is justice? Justice is everyone who gets his due. So therefore, social justice means that everyone is considered, first of all, as a child of God, the dignity, the human person. And this dignity, it's common to everybody. It's not only that one that is deserving to the rich, to those who are able, to those who have studied, those who are educated, but every person has this dignity. And therefore, the church repeats, as it were, this fundamental right, or what we call the human right, to say that justice is equal, justice is formal, and there is no partiality in justice. This particular concept came up, of course, in the church. It was there from the beginning. But Pope Leo XIII in 1891 brought out what's called the encyclical called as Rerum Novarum, New Things. And from then onwards, the church has been constantly stressing on the human rights, the justice part of it. So therefore, when the church celebrates this, it reminds that in the church, there should not be any inequality. You know, this caste system, sometimes perhaps it has even come to our Christian churches and communities. In some places, there is the Dalit, we call it. They are not accepted in the community. They have to sit separately. They have to be perhaps given separately. They have to be treated separately. In some places, perhaps they have to be even buried separately. Not only here in the world, but also even after death, they are discriminated. And therefore, the church says it's a big scandal. It's a big scandal, and therefore we have to learn to remove this, what we call injustices, in being partiality to the people, and see that justice is done to everybody. So this is the meaning of celebrating the Justice Sunday in the church. In the Archdiocese, we are going to inaugurate a special hostel for the Manipuri children. As you know, up to now, almost 700 people have come into Bangalore and the other parts of Karnataka. Out of them, 530 children have been put in school and colleges, in different schools and colleges. Almost 20, 25 schools have taken, many of them religious. And some of these who are in their schools are also given hostel facilities and everything free of cost. Everything of free of cost. Fortunately, there are some people who are supporting us. Thanks be to God that this, what's called the human kindness, flows very strongly in our Archdiocese. God be blessed. And therefore, we also thought, since there is such a big group that has come, and hostel or keeping them, giving them boarding and lodging has been very difficult, so we thought we would open up one of our hostels that's called St. Aloysius Boys Hostel in the St. Aloysius Middle School in the Cathedral campus. I have just inaugurated it today, this morning, and about 30 boys will be shifting there, those who have come from Manipur, and I am sure they will have a comfortable stay. Many of them are going to St. Germain's College, some of them are going to St. Aloysius College, and they will be there, surely enjoying our hospitality, at the same time studying very well. I am happy to know that they are very clever children. The IQ is quite high. They are very good in singing and they love football. The way they play football, I think I won't be surprised if some of them reach the not only the state level but also the national level. It's a beautiful group. So therefore, we still continue asking you for your support and help. And surely God will bless you for the support that you extend for these displaced children and youth who have come all the way from Manipur in order to enjoy their hospitality amongst us. There are two feasts that perhaps I should mention to you. First is on the 22nd of August. we celebrate the feast of the queenship of Mother Mary. Mother Mary, we say mother and queen. It's beautiful because in our earthly jargon, we call her our beloved mother. But at the same time, we are proud to say she is Queen Mother. Is Queen Mother. You know, this title, as our this feast began to be celebrated from 1954 onwards, when Pope Pius XII, he had a Marian year, the whole year. And at the end of the Marian year, that year it happened to be 31st of May, he instituted this feast as Mary, Mother and Queen of Heaven and Earth. And naturally, this feast is celebrated close to the Feast of the Assumption of Mother Mary, 15th of August. And within 7 days, this feast of 22nd is celebrated as Mary, Mother and Queen. And as Mother and Queen, she is close to Jesus, who is the King, and surely she will intercede for us for our needs. And we also, we ask Mother Mary all her help and support. And as a queen, she is generous. She is rich in her mercy and compassion. And she intercedes for us very strongly in order that we convert ourselves every day. At the same time, we open ourselves, our joys and sorrows to her in all our needs. 24th of August, we have the Feast of Apostle Bartholomew. Another, I would say, a strange apostle. You know, the way he enters the Bible scene, he is brought to Jesus by Philip. And when Jesus is sort of choosing his first disciples, Philip brings Bartholomew to Jesus. And the moment Philip tells him that Jesus has come from Nazareth, at once burst out and says, it's so spontaneous. He doesn't even know how to be respectful. Like, he tells before Jesus, what good can come from Nazareth? What good can come from Nazareth? And Jesus, looking at him, says, here is a guileless man, a man who doesn't consider what he's saying, but says straight from the heart, is a guileless man. And when Jesus tells him, I have seen you under the fig tree, he's shocked. How could Jesus have seen me? And he burst out and said, Jesus, you are Son of God. And so St. Bartholomew is credited with the first address or the first title in the Bible, in the New Testament, to have called Jesus as a Son of God. We are told that he was not only a straightforward apostle, perhaps by being critical, he learnt much from Jesus, and especially the message of the cross that others perhaps found difficult to understand, but Bartholomew knew that through the cross is a salvation, and he followed Jesus till the end. We are told that he went as an apostle to Asia Minor and also Armenia, and so he is considered as the apostle of Armenia and Asia Minor, and surely he must have died as a martyr. Not much is known about his death, but all the apostles, they were filled with that fire of the word of God and preached and proclaimed the word till the end of their life. They laid down their life like St. Thomas, like Peter and the other apostles. So therefore, the feast of St. Bartholomew is a feast once again to declare that we have faith in Jesus, and our faith has to be very strong. My dear friends, I would like also to tell you that perhaps the next week, there is a film that is very important that will be going round into the Archdiocese. We will be showing it in some places, in St. Joseph's, Christ University, perhaps also in St. John's Medical College, and later on maybe in other places. The film is called The Face of the Faceless.
ഉൾക്കടിയിലെയും പാവപ്പെട്ട മനുഷ്യരുടെ ജീവിതത്തെക്കാൾ സങ്കടകരമാണ് അമ്മച്ചി ഇവിടുത്തെ ആദിവാസികളുടെ സ്ഥിതി.
इस सारी फसाद की जड़ वो औरत है, इसका कुछ ना कुछ तो उपाय निकालो अमर सिंह.
क्या करते हो तुम लोग?
हमारे गांव के बच्चे हैं मदर जी, बकरियां चराते हैं.
अगर हो सके तो आगे से बच्चे को बकरी चराने मत भेजना.
मदर जी, आप अपनी जिंदगी हमारे संघर्ष में क्यों बिता रही हो?
काम का पगार सिर्फ खाना।
अच्युत तो सिर्फ आदिवासी है, उनका पैसा नहीं है ना साहब।
तेरी हिम्मत कैसे हुई हमारे सामने बात करने की?
बात करेंगे।
तुम लोगों को अपने गांव में आत्मसम्मान के साथ जीने का अधिकार है।
इस गांव में चाहे बीमारी आए, लोग मरे, इस औरत का उससे क्या?
सिस्टर रानी मरियर, दिस इज योर लास्ट वार्निंग।
ये लोग आपके गांव वाले या रिलेटिव तो नहीं लगते?
आप हमको छोड़ के मत जाइए मदर जी।
गांव वालों को कैसे जीना है ये हम तय करेंगे।
चाहे कुछ भी हो जाए, मैं उनके साथ खड़ी रहूंगी। और दूसरों के लिए प्राण अर्पित करने से बड़ा और कोई प्रेम नहीं है।
Once again, the confession of faith by a modern saint called Blessed Rani Maria. And the people who have produced this film have met me. In fact, the Cardinal Gracious phoned up to me and said, it's a beautiful film, Bishop Peter, recommend it to your people so that they see it and they are convinced of the faith witness of Rani Maria, which is just recent. Hardly 25-30 years back, you know, Rani Maria comes from a place. She was born in Kerala, but she went as a missionary to the central India, to Bhopal, to Indore. And there she was not only preaching the word of God, but more doing social work. She was trying to liberate the women from their bonded labor and also from this other evils of the what we call the slavery to sin, etc. And this irritated the high caste people, and they were after her. And at one time and one occasion when she was traveling in the bus, they sort of killed her with almost 20-21 stabs. And the person who stabbed her was of course caught, he was put into prison, but Rani Maria's family forgave him. He's still alive, and he not only has regretted what he has done, but now he has almost become an apostle to say that Christianity or Christ has meaning. So I recommend this film, what's called The Face of the Faceless, that will come to Bangalore. Surely the people who have produced it are small people who have put in a lot of money, their own money, and therefore I told them that we will try to collect also some little money for them so that for the trouble that they have taken, money or not. Film is beautiful, and I hope that all of you will see it. The first show will be on the 27th of this month, that's the next Sunday. Please be prepared for it in St. Joseph's College, and later on it will be also in the Christ University Hall. I now speak to you about the family. You know that this is the year of the family in our archdiocese. And for this, it's not just programs that we conduct. It's not just celebrations that we had. We have to look, we have to gauge, we have to improve the quality of our families. You know, I can't produce programs for my family every day. I can't have slides and clips every day to show my films. Perhaps I can send some photos of families here and there, but ultimately, the living of the family is in the family. You have the same husband, you have the same wife, you have the same children, you have the same corner, you go to that same pillow. You know, family is things that are done daily, but in a special way. The faithfulness of the couple together, the humility of the parents, you know, to serve their children. And very often, perhaps the children may not understand at this age the love and sacrifice of their families, but everything matters. Everything matters, that's the family. So therefore, on 27th of August, that's the next Sunday, in St. Peter's Seminary, there will be a seminar to discover the meaning of the family. The meaning of the family. I would request More and more couples go for this, because from then onwards we can take up a journey for the families, individual families, because what happens in a family is something unique to your family. We can't say, perhaps we can say something in common, but my family is my family. Problems of my family are special. The joys in my family are, which I would say, something superb. But then it is something related to my family, and therefore we need to focus on each one's family. I would request that you attend this seminar on 27th of this month. And by and large also, every day there is something or other by our Family Service Center. And we are going to have on Sunday, this Sunday, 20th, in Jalahalli, we will be opening up a family counseling center for the people of Jalahalli and the others there. I know that some can come to the central family service center that's in Palana, but perhaps if the people would like to go to the nearby places wherever we have opened the family service centers, family counseling centers, especially couples who are in problem, the youth who would like to seek solace, the children perhaps who are also perturbed and have discovered certain problems, differences, all of them can be helped in this family's counseling center that is being opened on 20th of July, that's on this Sunday, at Jalahalli. My dear friends, perhaps there are so many things that are happening at the same time. But it's not that, as I said, the slides that we go on moving at each other, unless we are involved, unless each of us plays our attention and takes interest in them, they will be only slides or pictures. I would like to be part of this particular, what we call, the moving force of the Archdiocese, to organize yourself, to involve yourself, and at the same time to participate in the many good things of the Archdiocese. We have our problems, we have our challenges, we have our difficulties, but then, as the Gospel would say, depending on our faith will be the response that we get from God. I wish you a blessed Sunday.
By our beloved Archbishop, Most Reverend Dr. Peter Machado, the Archbishop of Bangalore, who takes so much of interest and concern in order to bring the various topics, the contextual aspects, in order to inform, educate, and catechize all of us, the priests, the religious and faithful of this vast archdiocese. And I'm sure you are enjoying this program, Shepherd's Voice, and I request each one of you to share with your other colleagues, friends and family and relatives, near and dear ones, so that everyone in this archdiocese can be more closer to listen to the Archbishop on this Shepherd's Voice, the weekly feature. My dear friends, as I've always told, that this is a wonderful platform wherein we can connect to the Shepherd of this Archdiocese, wherein he brings in the interesting topics in order to increase our devotion and love towards God, and also to know the spiritual matters that concerns our faith. In a very special way, you are most welcome to raise, to ask your questions, queries, and you can send them to us at archdblr@gmail.com, and you will also see our mobile number in and through which you can connect with our media center, Aave Studios, and the Archdiocesan Communication Center. Please do write to us your feedback, your opinions. Thank you. Continue to watch and continue to share with others.